probably hear you. You all said hello. That's a good start. So thank you very much for your attention this afternoon. My name is Olly Cooper. I'm the CEO of Bijou Commerce. I'm actually going to be talking to you about another business which has come out of the Fuse stable of companies today, which is called Researcher. So I'm going to take you very quickly through what Researcher is. You can't hear me very well. Can you hear me less now? Is that better? Okay, I'll just put it a bit closer to my mouth. That's probably sort of all out. Okay, let me start again. So my name is Olly Cooper. I'm the CEO of Bijou, but I'm actually going to be talking to you about Researcher, which is another company launched by Fuse, Glenn Chalcott's kind of mini mobile incubator. So I'm going to cover very quickly what Researcher is, what problem it is that we've been solving, why we're excited about it as a business, and progress so far. So, Researcher's mission is to connect scientists to the people, tools, and the information they need to make the biggest breakthroughs faster and to become the best scientists they can be. And we do that through three kind of pillars of activity: discovery, learning, and connections. So we help scientists discover content that's relevant to their research. We help them learn and develop as scientists and educate them as to how to be better in their profession. And then we help them to connect with colleagues and peers, because that's such an essential part of scientific discovery and the discovery process. So the problem we're solving is one of productivity in research. Now, if you did study science or engineering at university, which I'm sure a lot of people in this room did, I'm sure you will have encountered academic journal articles which talk about very specific areas of research. And there's been an enormous explosion in the amount of this information that is published every year, to the extent there are now about 25,000 peer-reviewed journals publishing millions and millions of papers every year. So if you're a scientist, your task is very hard to stay up to date with all of the information that could be relevant to you. You can think about it this way. If you're studying a very particular subject, you need to know if someone else is studying that same subject, or someone else publishes a paper on the same research area, or if someone has come up with an idea or a concept that makes your research not so useful. You're terrified of the idea of going to a scientific conference, presenting your findings that you've been working for years on, spending lots of your time on, and then someone puts up their hand and says, hey, you haven't encountered or haven't looked at or haven't taken account of this piece of research, which was published in this obscure journal that you had no idea about. That's embarrassing, and it can be very damaging to people's careers. And so scientists spend around 10 to 15 hours a week just manually searching for relevant papers. And that means going on journal websites, it means talking to colleagues, it means spending time on social media, just searching out little pieces of information that could be relevant to their research. And obviously that's a lot of time for individuals, but when you take that and kind of put it into the world of business, businesses that are employing thousands of scientists trying to develop drugs or make other scientific breakthroughs, that amount of time costs a huge amount of money. And if you look at just the pharmaceutical industry, for example, the average drug to bring it to market costs nearly $3 billion. You think of that amount of time and that amount of money. If you save even a few days or a few hours a week, scientists' time who are trying to bring that drug to market and to prove that it works, then you're saving that company a huge amount of money. And also, again, just taking a look at the pharmaceutical industry, the industry is getting less and less efficient. It's actually halving in productivity every decade. So there's this huge issue that affects everybody from the individual researcher all the way up to the biggest multinational companies spending lots and lots of money on this stuff. And it's a very basic problem. How do you make sure the scientists have an easy way to find out about relevant scientific information? So why are we doing this now? There are a few different factors, but the main ones are, the academic publishing industry is ripe for disruption. I actually had a career in academic publishing before I joined Blenheim Charcot. And without going into too much detail, there are all sorts of opportunities to attack what is essentially a legacy business and a legacy business model built around publishing physical papers and selling copies of these journals to libraries and institutions on multi-million pound subscription deals. And again, I told a story to the Bijou team yesterday about how the publishing model actually works. And again, without going into too much detail, you can have situations where a government-funded institution ends up paying a publisher to publish research that the publisher then sells back to that same government-funded institution. And publishers are double-dipping in their business model all over the place. So that's one big factor. Another big factor is that, as you all know, content consumption on mobile is going through the roof. People are watching films, they watch YouTube, they will listen to podcasts, listen to audiobooks, all sorts of stuff, even just reading magazine articles. It's all going mobile. But academic and scientific research hasn't followed that trend yet, and actually less than 10% of all journal articles are consumed on mobile devices, which we think is a huge opportunity. We've also got this exciting set of developments in artificial intelligence, natural language processing, and machine learning, which allow organizations like us to examine the enormous amount of content that's being published very quickly in a very granular way. So we use machines to understand what a piece of content is actually about and which might be the very specific relevant pieces for individual researchers. That just wasn't possible a few years ago. Now the technology is advancing and advancing very, very quickly, and we can make use of that to make predictions, to understand what content's about, and so on. And the other thing is that this increase in the amount of content and the amount of, purely the amount of scientists and researchers working on these kind of problems in all settings, whether that's academic or in business or in engineering, is going up, and it's going up really fast. R&D spending is rising very, very quickly, and the numbers of people who have this problem is getting larger and larger and larger. So what's our product? We started, if you remember at the beginning, I talked about these three pillars: discovery, learning, and connections. Well, we started with discovery. So the product that we launched back in October last year is called Researcher. It's available as an app and on the web as well. And it's basically a tool that does one very simple thing. It lets the scientists keep up to date with all the relevant papers that could be useful to them in their pocket or on their desktop without them having to go out and search for them every single week. So the basic experience is quite simple, and really the key value that we are delivering to scientists is just efficiency. They don't have to spend the amount of time that they do currently on social media, talking to their colleagues, putting stuff into search engines, because they can just set up a filter on Researcher, they can follow all the journals that they might be interested in on Researcher, and then they get a nice, simple feed to look through, and anything that's useful, they can save and use in their research workflow later on. We've got some really exciting new features coming up later on. Probably the most important one is taking what is essentially a nice kind of single player experience with Researcher, a nice productivity app, and turning it into something that is much more social and allows people to share papers very, very easily within their lab groups and their research groups. And that's coming out over the next couple of weeks, actually, or a couple of weeks, probably a month or so. So how have we been doing? I mentioned we launched Researcher properly in October last year, but actually the story goes back a little bit further than that. Some of you might remember the product Stack. Anyone? Hands up if you remember Stack. Yeah, a couple of people nodding. So Stack was something that we started off back in 2016. And the idea behind Stack was kind of exactly the same as Researcher. People are interested in specific topics, but it takes a lot of effort to stay up to date with them. So why don't we create something that brings in all sorts of different news and general interest stories, understands what people are interested in, and brings those stories to people very, very machines in. And we built stack, we built some machine learning stuff, actually that all sits behind Researcher. The only thing that we did, we found out that we needed to do, was take the general interest problem and turn it into something that's focused very tightly on a niche. And also, in doing that, we went from the proposition being, hey look, anyone, if you're interested in anything, you can use Stack to keep up with it, which is a bit too wide, doesn't really create a sort of burning problem, and applied it to a set of people whose jobs, whose reputations, whose career advancement all depend on them staying up to date with one very specific thing. So if you think about it just purely in business terms, we took something that was sort of, you know, a nice to have thing, it's a bit, you know, it's convenient, I don't have to spend lots of time looking up stuff that's interesting to me. And we focused it very, very narrowly to a group of people who really burn to have that problem solved. Anyway, so we switched our attention to focus on researcher, focus on the academic and scientific community in the beginning of 2017. And we did a closed beta test with a load of chemists at UCL over the summer and got some great response. And great usage out of that, great feedback. And then we did a marketing supported launch in October last year. At Christmas we had 12,000 scientists using the app, and as of today we've got nearly 360,000 scientists using the app. And the growth rate has been really phenomenal and exciting. And a very large proportion of those users have come onto the app organically, and actually there's nearly 100,000 scientists and researchers in India using Researcher. Incredibly exciting. India is actually the biggest single country by usage. Although we're all over the world, and we're very pleased to be invited to put Researcher into the Chinese app store by Huawei. And that went live a couple of weeks ago, and there are a few thousand Chinese scientists and researchers using it as well. But really, the things that are exciting are the number of people who are engaged and very highly engaged, even though there's no retention features in the app. There are hardly any notifications, you don't get email digests. Anybody who's using Researcher is using it just purely because the core experience is good and solves the problem for them. It's great to have good review score averages on the app stores, and we get fantastic feedback from people who email us saying, oh, this is great, thanks for doing this, this is really solving the problem for me, which is very gratifying. But it's that weekly growth that's just incredibly exciting. Every week, the user base grows by, it's actually just under 10% now, but that's still a very large number. And the other key bit of progress actually is in the subject coverage. And we started off really focused on life sciences, and then we added medicine, healthcare, and pharmaceuticals. And then around Christmas we added AI and machine learning. And then actually over the last few weeks we've added social sciences, psychology, business and marketing. And actually there's now a ton of really, really good content on there. And I mentioned at the top that there are about 25,000 peer-reviewed journals in the world. We now are, one of our big objectives is to get up to that 25,000 mark so that you can be really comprehensive about all the content we cover. Because the biggest barrier to people using our app is actually, can they find the content that's relevant to them? And if we don't have the one key journal that they use all the time, forget it, they won't use us. So in terms of the future, what's our strategy? It really hinges on three things. And the first one is just taking what we've done with Researcher and continuing to improve it, make it better and better and better, and keep pushing it to the scientific and research community. One of the things I didn't flag up, that was on a slide a few slides ago, was the number of scientists and researchers there are in the world. We think there's about 14 million. So we've got about 360,000 of those 14 million using us right now. And what we want to do is get half of those at least, something like 5, 6, 7 million over the next couple of years. And if we manage to do that and keep them engaged, then there are a huge number of interesting possibilities that open up to us. But that's our number one priority. Really, that number one, that little dot should be much, much bigger, because it should show the priority of where we're at. If we manage to do that, we're going to generate a huge data set which we can start to exploit. So not only do we have all of the content that we're they're engaging with it, we can start to do some really interesting stuff about identifying who is an expert in a given scientific field. And actually, in some ways, it's quite easy to look at a given scientific field and say, hey, look, we can see who's published the most, who's published most frequently, and who's published the most influential papers and that kind of stuff. But what that doesn't take into account is that a lot of research is years and years and years in the making. And actually, somebody who's a real expert right now might never have published in that field. But because we know what people are actually reading and what they're sharing, that then lets us identify those experts before they become the stars in their field. And we think that's really exciting. We know that publishers think that's really exciting as well. The other thing that we can start doing is start making predictions. So we already know what research is trending, what research areas are trending, but actually we can start to make predictions around that. So we can say, hey, look, the next big thing in DNA is protein folding, or the next big thing in chemistry is studies around porphyrins or something like that. We can also start to predict when people are about to publish, which is incredibly valuable if you're a publisher. Because at the point when somebody's about to publish a paper, you can hit them with some advertising saying, hey, publish your paper in our journal. And that's really, really valuable because it's such a competitive landscape out there for publishers trying to sign up all the best authors. And then once we've got that highly engaged user base, that fantastic database that we can start to use, we can then monetize both of those assets with companies that have great established business models with lots of margin in them, that have a lot of money and want to access both our data and our audience. And I'm talking there about academic publishers and pharmaceutical companies, two of the most kind of successful business models in terms of if you just look at the profit margins that they generate. So we're really excited about this business because if we can capture the attention of what is essentially a very, very valuable segment of people in scientists and researchers and monetize that attention with people who have a lot of money and a lot of room in their business models, we feel that this can be a really great and exciting business. So you won't be able to see all this. This is our roadmap over the next 3 years, or 2.5 years, I guess. And the really critical things are that we have plans for how we continue to advance our proposition in discovery by making researcher even more sticky, even better for users, and getting up to that kind of 5 million, 6 million, 7 million user mark. In learning, we are going to launch later on this year a learning resource for early career scientists where we'll have hundreds of articles about how to become a better scientist, how to present at a conference, how to network, how to understand the different ways of measuring how important or impactful your research has been. And then in connections, we're introducing the social features that I talked about earlier on, but we've also got some other product ideas that don't have as big a market as research does, perhaps, but could be very, very valuable within niches, within the niche of academic and scientific research. So an example is research in ChemEx, which we're doing some work on at the moment, which is essentially a chemical exchange where chemists doing research, they spend a lot of time building molecules. They do all sorts of complicated reactions, and it takes them weeks and weeks to develop this molecule. And then if they need 100 grams of it, they'll make sure to make a kilo of it, because they never know when they might need it again. But actually, most of the time, they only use that 100 grams or maybe 200 grams, and then they never use it again. They put it in a freezer and they forget about it. And this is an amazing opportunity for other people within that community to use what's already been made. And so that's kind of the premise behind ChemEx. And then finally, these two bottom rows, these are about monetization and about value creation. Because obviously, we're in this business to create a valuable business and to make money out of it. And there are a few different ways that we're thinking of monetizing researcher. The really key ones are selling access to the audience, and that could be in a number of different ways. So it could be through promoted content. It could be that GlaxoSmithKline, one of the biggest pharmaceutical companies in the world, has just come out with a new study on an emphysema drug, and it really wants to make sure that all of the world's experts in emphysema know about this study, and they'll pay to promote it. They'll pay a lot of money to promote it to the right people who can identify who those right people are. Another method that we are looking into is actually stemmed from a business that came to us. It's a Danish business called Novozymes, which is a $20 billion turnover business. A load of their researchers already use Researcher, they love using it, and they said, can we have our own premium version of Researcher where we can control who logs in, we can add a little bit more content, we can do some custom content feeds, and report on what our scientists are reading. Can we pay you for that? So we said, yeah, great, that sounds good. We'll develop that in Q4. And there's a couple of other interesting ways we can do that. In the value creation row, we're really going back to what I was talking about with regards to making predictions. Predicting when people are going to publish, predicting who's going to be a star, predicting what new methodologies and new molecules are going to be used. And all of those things are valuable. We know they're valuable. Well, we thought they were valuable, and then we validated that with people from in the biotech industry at pharmaceutical companies. So that's all I'm going to say. But I mean, the Researcher is an incredibly exciting project. But I think the sort of big lessons in it for me are, you know, as is common with a lot of VC businesses, you start off with one hypothesis, as we did with Stack, and we had to refine it. We were given the opportunity to refine it, and then we found product market fit. We've had a great opportunity to go to market and create something that people really like and is growing excitingly. But it took us that thinking and that change in the business model to get there. And the future is very bright and exciting for Researcher. That's it. Thank you very much.
Any questions for Olly?
So the question is, if anyone in the office would like to have a look at Researcher, but look at some content that which might be interesting for you, yes, there is. So if you're a marketer, for instance, we have a lot of journals, business and marketing journals that you can have a look at. And what I'd say is the best thing to do with it is go in, download the app, it's free. All you need to do is search for Researcher on the Google Play Store or the App Store, and create a filter about something that you're interested in. So if you're interested in email marketing, for instance, in a channel, you can just put email marketing as a filter, and it will keep turning up new and interesting articles using that filter. And we also cover some finance journals for anybody working in finance. We have computer science journals, mathematics journals, AI. So there's quite a lot of stuff in there. We also are, I mentioned, getting up to that 25,000 target. At the end of this week, we're going to be adding another 2,500 journals that have already been onboarded, thanks to the team here who are onboarding, and they're going to go live into production, so there'll be even more content. But that's the best way to do it. And there are quite a lot of general interest business topics and business journals in there as well, so anybody studying for any qualifications will find something interesting. And obviously, I'd love to have your feedback. If you do use it, then let me know.
Sounds good. Anything else? There's one more.
So, if I'm using the app and if I find an article from my interest, so are you also giving reference of the article or is it published from your own researchers?
The question, if anybody missed that, was if you find a relevant article in Researcher, is that just from our own research, or is it from, can you cite it, is it from a publisher? So the content is all from academic journals that have been published by academic publishers. Later on, we'd love to allow people to put their own research on there, but at the moment, this is just stuff that is out there being published by the big academic publishing houses. And then in terms of how you then use that content, we integrate with a what's called a citation manager, people who were at university and used and wrote essays or looked at studies, you'll remember having to cite an article, cite a book at the bottom of your essay when you said, oh yeah, that was written by, wrote it in 2017, and the title of the article was this. There are a lot of pieces of software which allow you to do that, and we're integrating with those. We've integrated one at the moment, and we're going to integrate the two next biggest over the next few weeks. So that's it. That's how we manage. Can you download the concept? It's a question. You can. The big issue here is obviously, if you're a publisher, you have you don't want to give away access to content which is behind a paywall. So what we do is this: if you're a researcher who is at an institution where that institution has already paid to have access to the content you see on Researcher, you get access to the full article and you can download it as a PDF and do whatever you want with it. If you're not, what happens is that you see a preview of the article, and if you try and download it, what will happen is that you'll hit the publisher's paywall. So yes, you can download as a PDF if you have legitimate access. But obviously we don't want to upset publishers, we don't want to cause any trouble there, because we're relying on them to give us the content. Anyone else? Cool. All right, well, thanks very much for your attention, everybody. Enjoy the rest of your day.